Where'd you get that from?
It's handy, wasn't it?
Put it on.
No, what is it?
That's the
he can't hear because he's got his. Put your headphones on.
Why? Was it?
You'll
was
love it. You'll love it.
Yeah.
That's magnificent.
Yeah.
That's now Ricky Gervais's theme tune.
Yeah.
Every time we start the show, we should just start with that.
Win, Ricky, win.
Carl, do you just want to have a dig at me? Because it's coming up to 2 o'clock, and you've not really put a lot of effort in today, slagging me off.
I don't do it on purpose.
No, he doesn't do it on purpose. He's just an honest northerner, and he can't lie. He's like George Washington, but without the wooden teeth.
Yeah.
I don't think your heart's in it anymore either, Carl.
I was all right today, but Steve's really dragged me down.
Well,
wait a minute, I just need to know why.
No, do you know, like, yeah, people are being miserable around you?
Yeah.
I was full of beans when I came in.
Yeah,
but you got to remember last week, you were really miserable and that really wound me up.
Yeah, because he was having to do stuff. Because, you know, he'd been let down and they were worried about the next show.
Yeah, last week you were in a terrible mood.
Yeah.
Look at me like you were. Songs, I wasn't, like, going off and lying on the settee, looking ill, talking in that voice.
Oh, he's done you again.
I said, just now, being quite friendly.
Carl?
Steve?
Carl, have you ever tried to get into the Monarch for free? Because I'll be honest, mate, it's not going to happen for you. Come out with me, mate, you got a quid off. All right? When you can get in places in Camden for free.
Yeah, I'm all right, yeah.
Oh, yeah, he's done you. Do you not care about the job? I mean, I've got to ask because, you know what I mean, if I was in charge, I'd worry about your motivation or... Because yesterday we were trying to work out what you enjoyed doing and we got to Manchester United and moaning. And that is the two we came up with.
I don't know where you get the moaning thing
from.
You're
always whinging.
About what?
Everything.
When did I last have a moan?
Just before we came on air.
Right, and why was that?
I don't know, I can't remember. We were in a good mood, me and Rick.
I'll tell you why.
Go on.
Because you brought a song in at 10 to 1.
Yeah.
With a load of effing and jeffing in it.
Yeah.
And saying, can you edit this?
Yeah.
Yeah.
But that's your job.
You could have brought it in yesterday.
No, I couldn't.
Why not?
I hadn't thought of it.
Hmm.
But why are you whinging? That's your job. And I didn't come in 10 minutes before. It was a good 20 minutes before. It just took you ages because you were whinging and moaning to even get started.
Been very quiet week. Been checking. I was looking in books last night and stuff.
Is there any monkey news?
I've got some, but just because it's not that good, something else I found out that I thought I'd share with you.
Go on.
I was looking in the Guinness Book of Records, right? Because I thought they'll have something in there about monkeys or something. Right?
Mm-hmm.
And there's a little monkey, I think it lives in Asia, right? There's loads of them live in Asia.
Might just be travelling, but yeah.
And, something they found out, I don't know if they've got it right, and that's why I want to bring it up. Apparently, it's the mammal, right, that's got sort of the pointiest eyes. Eyes that pop out of their head. Steve. Now, the thing is, right, I thought that's interesting.
Yeah.
Apparently it's the biggest with the sort of goggle eye type thing.
Yeah. Right, yeah, go on.
Apparently, they come out of their head, 1.6 centimetres.
1.6 centimetres? What, you mean they protrude?
Yeah. They protrude from the head at 1.6.
Okay.
What, how long?
Have you got a ruler, Rick? 1.6.
He's having a go.
I'll tell you, I'd be a little bit annoyed if the monkeys beat me.
Well, I don't think it has.
That's what I'm hoping.
Is there anything we can... I mean, what's 1.6? Oh, can you...
It's about...
Drop your trousers.
It's, about 3/4 of an inch.
What do you think?
I don't know.
Have they got it right, or what?
Maybe I should come down to Monkey World with you next week.
So anyway, so that's not the monkey news, that's just something that cropped up and
sure.
I do know once, when we were playing pool in the office, I think Lucy was your partner.
Yeah.
It was me and Ash versus you and Lucy, and you were having trouble because his glasses kept slipping down, so Lucy pushed his glasses up, his nose, but the glasses touched his eye. Do you remember that?
Yeah.
He started it.
Well, you're the one who joined in.
No, I know, and I feel bad now.
Yeah.
It makes me nervous when he goes, yeah. It's like, play a record.
No, I'm just trying to think about which part of your fat, middle-aged physique I can pick on.
The tits would be a good
Yeah,
start.
Yeah.
Oh, the belly.
Sure.
Oh, what do you think of that?
Oh, that's, what is that? How did you meet your girlfriend?
Through work.
What, through her work? What, you found out and said
you worked at the same place.
Oh, you're right.
Yeah. You're quite an enigma, aren't you? Could you give us more on that?
At work, you met her at work. What, she came in selling sandwiches? She was going through the bins outside. What do you mean you met her
at
work?
Why are you having an attack on me? You're the one who's sad and lonely.
No, he's done you again.
Yeah, but what I thought was interesting was I just scratched at him and he just went mental.
Yeah, no,
it's like a bear caught in a trap.
It's funny, isn't it? You'll never learn. Carl.
No, I was just interested to find out what the story was, because it might be a really romantic story.
Well, it's not.
All right, jeez. I love the fact he doesn't want to talk about his love affair.
I was thinking about you in the week, and like, does it worry you? I mean, you sort of joke about it now, and we're talking about it in the office, you know, like, oh, is Steve really touchy about the way he looks? And
what's this? Where's that come from?
He's done it again. He's done you again.
I was walking home the other night, and I was thinking about it. And do you worry that when you're old, you will be on your own?
You did start it, though, didn't you?
Well, Karl, I'm glad you brought this up. Because, no, because, I mean, for me, you know, a lightweight, frothy entertainment show on XFM on a Saturday afternoon is exactly the place where I want to discuss the desperate, lonely future that's inevitably coming my way.
Oh, God. I'll tell you what will cheer you up and forget all that. A bit of embrace.
Oh, one of the most hated bands.
Do you know when I left the pub in a bit of a mood? Because I just fed up with not getting anything done.
Yeah.
Walking down the road, I was thinking, how can I get out of this? How can I stop having to work with them? I'm thinking, I wonder if I leave, I wonder if they'll be funny and they'll go, and then my boss will be giving me stick. I'm thinking, how much notice have I got to give out? And all this is going through my mind. I'm walking home and I got in, said to Suzanne, I'm sick of it. She's going, you need to do it when I get a new kitchen. And I was like, yeah, but how big does the kitchen need to be? I was saying, do we need a big kitchen? Can we get a small one? Have we got enough for a small kitchen? Do we need so many cupboards? Can we just have wood instead of steel? All this, try to get out of doing this.
Yeah. It's always just, I always feel like, you know, because I like to think that I'm not perhaps as bad as him.
Yeah, no.
You annoy me in different ways.
Like what? How does he annoy you?
Well, stuff that, you know, I come up with ideas, say cheap as chimps.
Yeah.
Rockbusters springs to mind. Yeah. 15 like Taiwan.
15 Taiwan. Let's just remind people what 15 Taiwan was.
It was a little feature that I wanted to give a run, you know, give it a little run, see if people like it.
The premise being?
No, there's no premise, it's just a title.
No, we were gonna get 15 sort of ornaments, you'd explain them, and then people would call up and say, that I'm from Taiwan.
See? Carl, you just explained why I didn't think that was a good idea. Yeah, by explaining
the funny thing is, Steve, right, I was walking down Regent Street on Monday, walked past one of these big stores, right, and they've got all famous quotes on the windows, right,
yeah.
And one of them was something like, an absurd idea is often a great idea.
Yeah.
Do you know who said that?
Go on.
Einstein.
Yes.
Which made me wonder, if you were his mate, would he ever have done E equals MC squared? Or would you have said, don't bother with that, it's not gonna work? Because that's all you seem to do, everything I come up with, you put down.
Yeah.
Well, that's one thing, he's negative, right? I don't know why he is. What else?
He messes me about, I get him concert tickets for stuff, and you say, oh, I didn't bother going.
Yeah,
that is annoying.
You come in, you know, 5 minutes to go with tracks that need editing.
Yeah. The little bag, that bag that was free.
Yeah, you got a free bag today, an XFM little rucksack thing.
Yeah.
You were like, oh, what's this rubbish? Yeah. Ricky said, I'll have it, they're great. You said, no, I want it.
Yeah.
Well, it was free, I need it. Yeah. I'll give that as a gift or something.
So, I mean, I think on reflection, Steve is probably a little bit more annoying than me.
I won't go that far. you are annoying. If I had to go away for a week somewhere, if it was a quiet place-
So you are again, aren't you? That's two orders you had this week, this year, I mean.
If it was a busy place, I'd probably go with you, because people, do you know what I mean, staring at me all the time and that, if I'm walking around with Steve.
Play record!
No, I'm just-
Can I draw up a list of reasons I don't like you, Karl?
Just being honest.
Well, I'll tell you, because the list of reasons I don't like you is incredibly long and getting longer.
Just saying.
Do you want another slap?
Okay.
Waiting for. By the way, Red Hot Chili Peppers on XFM 104.9. So, a few more shows. I hope Sony are happy.
Mm.
They should encourage. You know, we've only been radio, you know, a couple of years.
Exactly. Trying. You encourage young talent,
yeah,
like you.
Yeah. Instead of giving it to Radio 1 and Radio 2 and. Yeah.
The old war horses. We just had a quick email. I wonder if you could answer this. It's James from NWL. He says, Ricky, is Karl going to be on this week's show? Please let me know, as I may listen if he's not. sadly, oh, he is here. Oh, I mean, dear. People are already turning against you, Karl, because they've seen what's happened.
Yeah.
I think they've probably realised that we've.
I think we gave him too much. I think, exactly. I think we've got a spoiled sort of kid in our hands. It's sort of like, you know, we knew how bad he was, but we were trying to sort of bring him out of his shell a little bit.
Yeah.
Encourage, you've got to encourage sort of. Children like Karl.
Well, yeah, exactly.
Just sort of fend for themselves. Mm. I like the fact that Dickie Anderson had that wonderful rant. It was an articulate email. It was quite long, and he must have typed it immediately. I'm thinking, because he's a fan of the show and he thinks I'm a, you know, a genius, we need a PA.
Sure.
Don't we?
Yeah, yeah.
Do you reckon he'd come and work for us?
Well, he can't be any worse than what we've already got.
I know. So there you go. Then we're giving up radio. We're going to concentrate on television. Karl's going to probably go back to what your little, just doing your sound.
The thing I won a silver for at the Sonys. Funny that, isn't it?
Oh, you won a silver, did you?
I got a silver. Yeah.
Oh, yeah. What was that for?
For doing the proper job that I do here in the week.
Well, no, it was two of you for a start.
Yeah. Well, there's three of us. Can't even get a bronze. Now who's the weak link? Right.
Well,
bit weird, isn't it?
Let's not argue. We haven't got many shows to do.
To be fair, though, this show is I think it's more to do with the fact that you talk on this show that has brought us down.
Right, I haven't said anything hardly today.
No, well, this is an award-winning show potentially.
We'll add this one in for next year.
If you could just keep shtum, we might have a chance.
All right.
Well, coming up, right?
Come let's on. Put it behind us.
Okay.
Let's draw a line under it.
Stephen co-wrote and directed The Office and Extras with me. You may have seen him in Extras as the agent. You may have seen him briefly in The Office. He is a goggle-eyed freak.
Are you referring to the character there, are you? Or?
Yeah, whatever.
Thanks.
No,
it's just a little inconvenient.
I'm just trying to paint a picture for people at Christmas.
Sure.
Steve.
Yeah. I wouldn't say goggle-eyed. I think goggle-eyed freak's harsh. You know, these are designer specs. And right. Yeah, admittedly, I'm a little bit tall, but
6'7".
Yeah, but let's not have a go at that.
Karl, we've got more like this later. I think we should play a record. We've done introductions.
Pop a little song on.
But do you remember the first time you saw Steve?
Well, let's pop a little song on that. All right, chat about it in a bit.
All right,
all right.
Bruce Springsteen, bit of Bruce Springsteen. Now, it's difficult to describe Karl. I just think you'll have to get to know him over the next 2 hours. But we have taking the liberty of getting some stuff ready for you if you want to find out more about him. If you go to rickygervais.com, we've put up a special little page. Go into Who's Karl, and we've got a little biography up of him and loads of pictures. And you have never seen a head rounder. He looks like Mr. Spoon from Button Moon.
Yes.
Do you know what I mean? Yeah. Or Bod.
Yeah. Bod. Grown
up.
Almost
there's like a little bit of Charlie Brown in there. He's even got a little stripe shirt. It's perfectly rounded. It's balding, like to. And it's not a sort of like a good balding. It's sort of like he looks like a worn tennis ball. Do you know what I mean? He's got a little bit of growth.
It's not that sort of Teddy Savalas cool bald.
No, it's just a scruffy little. I don't know what it is.
Happy Christmas and that.
What do you think of that, then, Karl? Your introduction to the nation.
Well, you know, if we're going to start picking on looks and stuff, like you mentioned before, we can go over everyone in this room.
What
I mean, let's make it fair.
What?
Let's have a chat about Steve over there.
What are you talking about?
Well. You know how sort of I felt when I first saw you.
Wait, don't go mad, Steve. Let Karl speak. Right, this is his platform.
No, I'm just saying you just said about painting a picture.
Yeah, go on then.
I wouldn't paint a picture of that. No, I'm not, Steve, you know I'm not having a go, mate.
What do you mean you're not having a go? It sounds like you're having a go. Well, what did you think when you first saw him, when he first walked into that room all those years ago?
Sort of thought he looked like a cartoon.
No, no, Steve, you know, but you know that you look a little bit odd. This isn't like a shock to you. You've had this. How old are you now?
31,
right,
but
so
I don't
you're
know.
Like 31. What do you look like as a baby? I mean.
Why is this a character assassination?
No, no, I'm not having a go. I'm just saying what it was like. Now, I'm used to you now. When I see you, I don't sort of double take anymore. I just.
He's coming out with this?
No, but, you know, when you popped in and that, it was just a bit of a shock, and now, you know, I've got used to it and that.
Good, you're happy now, you can cope now.
Yeah. Hold on, you were shocked when you saw Steve Merchant. You told me once you went to school with two fellas who had big heads and webbed hands and feet. Yeah. And they weren't related. Why were there two people like that at your school, and yet you find Steve freaky?
You never said freaky. You said freaky.
Oh,
you said freaky.
Karl, just I don't want to. I'm not stirring it, right? You started a little bit of a war with Steve.
You always
are
stirring it.
Well, no.
This is what this is stirring right now. This is the terminology.
But do you know that the fellas in your school, the big heads and webbed feet and webbed hands,
webbed hands. Yeah.
But they hung around together, did they?
I don't think they did.
And they were nothing to do with each other.
No, I think people expected them to sort of knock about together, but they must have thought, oh, that'd be too obvious. Do you know what I mean?
But where did you live? Near a power plant? Well, I mean, why did you have-
I don't think it had anything to do with that, though. Just sometimes you get a little- look at Steve, he didn't live near a power plant. No.
Listen, can I just stop you there, right? Let me just stop you there, because it always happens. As soon as we you know, it's supposed to be a nice day, and suddenly you're having a go, right? Now, this got sent on the email, okay? Now, this is not me saying this. This is someone who's forwarded a review that was put on the web. It was a review of your appearance on one of Ricky's stand-up comedy DVDs, okay? I'm quoting this. This is not me saying it. It says that, Karl, through a combination of his intriguing way of thinking and slightly less than human appearance, right, Karl may just be the proof needed to muffle the cries of creationists the world over, as this missing link demonstrates that not only did man evolve from apes, but the process isn't quite finished yet. Okay, now that's someone else, an external person's opinion of you.
But
are you having a go at me?
The terrible thing about that is, Karl's feelings aren't hurt because he didn't understand a word of that.
I said the word creationist, that lost him.
That lost it. You've got to remember that Karl, you know when people say they're talking to their cat and they go, oh, look at him, look at this, it's like he can understand what we're saying. Well, Karl's got that look, but you know he can't understand what you're saying. All right, Karl? Mm-hmm.
No, but all I mean, now we're talking about your head and that, right? When you go back to, say, your mum and dad, it's Christmas time, right? There's a lot of people travelling up and down the country, going back to their mum and dad, they probably haven't seen them all year, right? When you go back, is it a shock to them again? No, do you know, like, how you get used to how someone, like I say, I'm used to you, I see you a few times a week, I don't do the double take. But what I mean is, when you go back, do they sort of go, oh, here he is.
Play a record. This is, it's, I.
Let's leave it then.
Let's move on then, because I'm going to get angry. And we haven't even got, it's not even 25 past
Christmas.
A little bit of Simon and Garfunkel.
Yeah, oh, this is beautiful.
Karl, it was you that worked out the maths and worked out I was 28, because they just worked out I'm 27.
You are 27.
No way.
Yeah, I asked you, didn't I? And
yeah,
I said
because, no, but what I sort of questioned was, I said, well, if you're 27 today, that means last week you were 26.
Well done, yeah. That's irrelevant. So therefore you assumed that I must be 28 then.
Yeah.
Whereas I assumed you were using, you know, your knowledge of maths,
no,
such as it is.
I wouldn't do that.
No, sure.
Wow. I actually got lost in that conversation because I genuinely didn't know what he meant would mean last week you were 26. I don't know what that meant.
I don't know what it meant.
Wow. Well, it is Steve's birthday.
He would have been 26 last week.
Sometimes you genuinely frighten me because it's those staring eyes. There's nothing behind him. It's this little bald head. Looks like Davros looking at me. Genuine, just genuine fear on his face when he enters into a conversation with another human being.
What bit don't you understand? If he's 27 today, he would have been 26 last week, and he doesn't look 26. He didn't look 26 last week. He looks older than 28 today.
You've started on his birthday, you're still having a go at him.
Karl, I don't look like the kind of hot stud that I actually am, but face facts, that's the truth, mate.
Yeah, live with it.
Get with the program, jeez.
So, what have you been doing this week, Steve?
Well, I'll tell you what, at the beginning of the week I was, incredibly annoyed by Karl.
Why?
Because I remember you had a little discussion with Karl a while back saying that, you thought he was lazy at times.
Yeah.
And, you know, you had various criticisms of his work.
Yeah, yeah.
And I got a call from him. He said, oh yeah, I should have told you, I had a phone call. Someone said that they were trying to get hold of Steve Merchant to offer him some lucrative voiceover work. Now, you know-
That is money for old rope.
It's money for rope.
That's about, you're in there for about 20 minutes and it's thousands of pounds.
If there are children listening who are still at school, they should definitely, when the careers guy says, what do you want to do? Try and get voiceover work. Just become a voiceover artist. It's money for old rope.
Yeah.
So I can't believe my luck, because, you know, I love money for old rope.
Yeah.
And, I said, well, what's the information? He said, oh, I don't know. I deleted the message. It was on his answer, and he deleted the message. I said, right, when did the message come? He said, last week. So he took a week to tell me that he had deleted the message.
Why, just because it wasn't for you?
I mean, I don't know how selfish that is, Karl.
No, what happened is, right, I got back off holiday.
Mm.
I was at home.
Yeah.
So I called up my voicemail, right, because I can do that.
Yeah.
Remote access, right, because I've got to know what's going on at work.
Of course.
Called in, it was still my day off, I was going through the messages.
Yes.
Heard one from some company saying, we're after Steve Merchant.
Yeah.
We want him to do some voiceover work.
Yeah.
Right. Mm. I can't remember the name of it, but
thanks.
I thought, right, I'll remember to tell Steve.
A week later.
It doesn't matter, does it? You still got the message, and they
what message?
Yeah, but voiceovers have to be done in the next couple of days.
I didn't get the message. I got, all I got was, there was a company, I don't remember the name, and they phoned you, they wanted voiceover work. How does that help me? There are hundreds of thousands of media companies.
You
didn't take down a number, you didn't take down a name, nothing.
I was more puzzled why they'd want you to voice anything.
I don't know why. But listen to that voice.
You must be annoyed. You must be annoyed.
I mean, talk about rubbing salt into the wound.
No, but listen to you.
God. I don't know what you, I don't know how you think, I don't know what, how your mind works.
Well, I was thinking there must be a tractor sale on somewhere.
I don't care if they want me to advertise, you know, the latest designs in pirate fashion wear. I will do a voiceover because it's money for the rope. I don't care what you think of my voice. Someone was interested, they were offering me money. And you decided arbitrarily, oh, they probably wouldn't want it, they probably made a mistake, they wouldn't like the way he talks anyway, I'll delete the message.
No, the thing is, right, I get paid to sit here on a Saturday, right, play CDs and that, help out with the show, get you decent prizes, I think I do me bit.
Sure.
Right? It isn't about running your voiceover work.
So hang on, so Karl, let me just get this right. If someone was ever to phone me, right, trying to get in touch with you, to offer you work, you'd want me to just ignore the message. That is what you're saying to me. You'd prefer that I deleted the message, I ignored it altogether. That's what you'd want for me to do. That's what you want me to do.
What, someone's calling you for some
Someone's phoned me, they say, oh, I can't, I don't know, I'm a friend of a friend, I've got your number, Steve, I would love to use Karl Pilkington for an exciting sex scene.
So has it happened?
Well, I'm saying in the future, if it was to occur, if it was to occur, do you want me to just ignore it? Is that what you prefer me to do?
Well, it's not like that, though. I did tell you. I told you the message.
You didn't what? You told me a week later with none of the information I needed.
Karl, that doctor called last week. That kidney's ready for that, little girl that you were doing that sponsored walk for. I forgot to tell you.
Oh.
I hope it's still alright. They keep it on ice, don't they? I think they do.
Selfish, Karl. So selfish. And you've lost us a second.
Well, I went out with a drink with Karl in the week, and, we went to a restaurant, didn't we, Karl?
Good night.
And we sat there, and next to me, when Karl came, next to me was, what's his name? Ross Kemp. And, he was sitting there, and I saw Karl, and I tapped him on the shoulder, Ross Kemp, and I pointed at Karl and him, and I said, it's nice to see you two back together again.
Nice.
And Karl was horrified. But Karl didn't know that I'd already spoken to him before Karl arrived.
I thought it was okay.
I thought I could break the ice because I'd met him before.
Sure.
So he just thought I was insulting him. And in the week we were talking about his head, his little head, weren't we, Karl? And Karl suddenly stopped the conversation and said, if I had hair, what would we be talking about now? I think he had enough of everyone talking about it. And he looked good though. He had it's a special little do. He had it sort of, you know, cropped a little bit more. I like it when he's just freshly had it done.
Mm.
Do you like, yeah.
Has that ever happened to you, Steve? When you, if you're somewhere, say if you sat somewhere, does someone sort of, you know, is he anyone else who you look like, or would you say you're a bit of a one-off?
I love these two.
But to be fair, he seems to be having a go at me an awful lot more than I do at him now. I mean, he just starts it, you know, he just starts it out of nowhere.
I think his is sort of a get back for the way you treat him as a producer, not, you know.
But he's not a producer! If he produced the show, I wouldn't have a reason to criticise, but...
I think this is it.
But seriously, I mean, it really winds me up though, because, you know, it started as a joke, but now it's just, it's abuse.
Yeah.
He got annoyed at Heat because it said Karl, the producer, well, not so much a producer, as just a bald mank. And he went, can they say that?
Yeah.
Can they say that?
See, that's a magazine, an independent publication has identified what exactly it is you do.
Yeah.
Here we go then, come on, bring it on, because here we go, he's looking at me, I know he's thinking, I can hear the cogs.
No, I'm not thinking anything.
It's vicious.
Yeah, that is true, never a true word, Blair Record. Beautiful. Bit of Snoop on XFM, yeah?
Mm-hmm.
Kicking it with
Ricky Gervais.
Sweet. Steve Merchant and Karl Pilkington. What has happened to Karl? Because Karl, I thought, is, you know, is this sort of sweet little buffoon, almost childlike in his ways. You know what I mean? Like Charlie Brown after some sort of head injury. And now he's. And now he's coming back like that, having a go, not caring about voiceover work. It's like, because Heat have written about him a couple of weeks, it's like he thinks he's better than you in some way.
I do care though, you're out of order saying that, right? Because I've sorted you out with tickets for stuff.
He doesn't turn up too.
Karl, I received a phone call, you deleted the message offering me voiceover work, you're as bad as my agent. I'm appalled by it. And I thought we were friends.
At least his agent, when he does it, is losing himself money as well.
Yeah, exactly.
You've got no comeback. You're still sweet. And to have a go at his, you've got a mank whine, right?
Full voice.
Like a cartoon Gallagher brother on Coronation Street. I mean, and Steve's, I mean, yes, Steve does sound like a Wurzel, but that doesn't, do you know what I mean? What about Jethro? Jethro does well. Jethro gets on Des O'Connor anytime he wants.
Just has to phone Des up.
And he's on there.
Straight on.
And he's whining like a Wurzel as well. So, you know, to say that is rubbish.
Alright, apart from that then, what else have I done? That's wound you up.
But that's a good starting point, because you haven't even apologised.
No, it's a shock, because that's the first time I've let you down. And I didn't really let you down, because I passed on the message.
You didn't- well, we've been through it. You didn't pass on the message. Saying I deleted a message for you is not passing on the message. Yeah. I mean, I just think what's happened is that you've got a little bit of celebrity now from the show.
I mean,
I've seen you being recognised in pubs and stuff, or people have come up and they said, are you Karl? Da-da-da, because they've seen Ricky. Now, it just seems to me that you are not keeping yourself grounded. You are just, you cannot deal with fame, you've not got the intelligence to cope with the celebrity, and you're just becoming this kind of ego-driven monster.
Now it's getting.
That scares me, Karl. You're not the man I remember.
Look, I put a lot of work into this on Saturday, this isn't even my proper job, right? Where were you in the week?
Oh, he's got you there.
What?
Where were you in the week? I said, let's meet up, let's, you know, come up with some new features and that. Where were you?
Karl, you phoned me about an hour before you wanted to meet. That is not what I would call. I mean, that is arrogance right there.
That's the way I work.
That's arrogance right there. That's ego right there.
He couldn't go, when I came in, he said, where's Steve? I said, Steve can't make it. I had to tell him why. Steve was staying in to tidy up because his landlady was coming. This he couldn't get over. He could not get over that you couldn't make it because you had to stay with your landlady. He talked about it for about the hour when we were working.
What are you talking? I last week I had a bad throat. You wouldn't tolerate that last week when you had
a bad throat. Where were you? Why couldn't we do any work then? Because you're at home with your mum and your dad.
You were on holiday, weren't you?
Why didn't you get your mum and your dad to clean the flat?
Oh, he's done it again! He's done you again, mate. Play a record.
How has he done me? What? They live in Bristol.
Yeah, the joke's on you. He couldn't get him to clean the flat.
I don't know who's laughing at who then.
Right, listen.
Can we just go back to laughing at Karl?
Okay.
Because I know where we stand there.
Okay, alright. Okay.
Do you want to,
that's the natural order of things.
I know, yeah.
The world's gone topsy-turvy.
He's stepped out of the pecking order.
Right, well, someone who I don't let down, right, are the listeners of this show. Do you want to, read out the prizes for Rockbusters? We'll get that one in.
Oh, we're not doing Rockbusters again, are we?
Yeah.
Well, it was a shambles last week. We cancelled it 2 weeks ago. What?
There you are right there, Rick. I mean, both you and I, and let's be honest, we're the guys with our names on the poster.
I know,
It's supposed to be your show. And
yet, our faces.
Exactly, and yet.
We have to be on tube stations with people laughing at us.
Yeah, well, they're not laughing at me, really.
I don't know. What do you think people think of the poster, Karl? Seriously.
No, I don't want to know his opinion. It's just gonna be insulting. My point is this, Rick. We used to be able to decide what the content of this show was.
I know.
It's him. It's just him. He wants to do Rockbusters. He gets to do it.
I know. And it's awful, Robert. Like Tourette's Trent Derby. Not only is that offensive, it doesn't work as a clue.
Saying that, have you come up with anything for this week?
What's the prizes?
Probably get the prizes. We've got.
Do you know what Steve said when he saw that, Karl?
Go on.
He said, it has captured Karl.
Mm. What do you mean?
Well, you just look utterly gormless. In the picture. It's captured you brilliantly. You know how, like, a good photographer can do that? You can capture the essence of someone. That's good stuff.
This is what the phone message he left me Wednesday on my mobile. But I just thought he's chatting about certain things that are going on at the moment. What he does need to know. Old Duncan, who he mentions, is my agent. And, you know, you understand a few other things. But this is the sort of message I get from Karl, right? Windsor.
Old messages.
Right. 10 past 12. Wednesday. Just getting loads of f***ing people calling me all the time about sh**. Yesterday, DVDs signing for BBC London. I don't work there, but I've been dragged into that. I've got a woman on, leaving a message from Talk PR going on about, do you want to go and see Pop Idol again? Right? They're just saying, you and some listeners can go. So I'm sure you'll love that. I've got Jim Benner wanting you to introduce the tin buckets at the Astoria. So can you just, like, let Duncan know that I'm doing his job whilst he's sat on his arse with his thumb firmly up his arse? Can you let him know that I'm running around like a c**t here sorting shit out for you? Alright, see you later.
Message left.
So, do you know what I mean?
I know, but that's the kind of phone message he's leaving. Do you remember who he was before you?
But he's even annoyed that he gets a phone call. I remember he got a phone call for you to do a voiceover and didn't pass it on. You missed a voiceover. That was thousands of pounds.
No, I did pass it on though. I told you.
You said someone had phoned.
Yeah.
That's not good enough.
But who's that?
Well, she didn't say, and I didn't ask. But
of course she said.
She didn't say.
Rubbish.
So you didn't take the number down? Just when she went, oh, can you tell Steve to call me? And you went, yeah.
Yeah, well, I just thought you'd know her already. I should have known. It was a woman, so I should have known.
He's having a go, you see?
Unbelievable. I don't know how it's come back on me. You're the one who was picking on it.
Yeah, exactly. I'm saying. I'm defending. Why is he having a go at you?
He never picks on Ricky because he knows you are his bread and butter. Seriously, do you know what I mean? The only reason he's got Mondays off is because you're still doing this show.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's why he's scared of you. That's why he's like, he has a go at you on the phone, but he always picks on me because he knows, you know, I'm a pushover. I'm a nice guy. He's scared of you. I can't believe it. I don't know how it works.
Is that true?
Steve, I'm always sorting you out. I look after you.
I'm sorting you out with tickets.
What do you mean you're sorting out tickets and lager? What's this?
Right, whenever you want tickets.
Yeah, yeah, it's all right.
I don't want to use this as, like, moaning time and that, because I don't like to moan. I'm busy and that, right? I've sorted you out tickets for gigs.
Yeah.
Right?
Well, some he doesn't even turn up to.
Yeah. We won't even go on about that. Yeah. Right? Lager.
He was sorting out The Cure. He complained it was boring.
Yeah. It was that big drum of lager that you had, and you said, oh, put that in your room for me.
Yeah.
Because I don't want to carry it home.
Right? I'm lazy.
So I said, all right, then I'll put it in my room. It goes missing, it gets nicked. Then you have a go at me because it got nicked.
Yeah.
I get you another one. You make me carry it around town for you for half an hour. Then you say, oh, I can't be bothered taking it home. Can you take it back to work for me?
Yeah.
Yeah.
But interestingly, this is like a year ago. So it's still pressing on you.
Oh, hang on. And I forgot the one when we had an argument over 50p.
Yeah, you didn't want to give me 50p back that you owed me.
That was the same day you'd given him about 40 quid worth of lager.
But, see, this is my point. This was my point at the time. It's not the 50p in terms of money is not what's important. The fact that you think you don't have to give me money back because it's only 50p, that was the point at stake. Mm. It's me who makes a decision, oh, don't worry about the 50p, not you. It's only 50p, I'm not going to give it to you. Do you know what I mean? There's got to be rules, otherwise it's chaos, Karl. Come on, mate. Alright?
I don't want to fall out about
it. No, it's not. Should we kiss and make up? Do you want that?
Play a little record and come back to this, because
I can't believe it started with you slagging him off, Rick, and I've ended up as the monster.
I know.
Bit of R.E.M.
Yeah.
It's best if you leave it.
Well, we're not going to leave it. We're going to get you on the poster.
Yeah. I mainly after seeing myself on videotape this morning.
The animal show I did, the show, I'm doing a video, and I did behind the scenes footage, and I've got you've seen it, haven't you?
I feel a little bit of Karl on there, isn't there?
Yeah, it's great, it's lovely, he can't believe it, he said, is it playing slow? Because he's so slow, and I come into the office going, alright. That's how you talk.
My head as well. I look like I'm looking into a spoon. I'm not happy with it.
I just think that if we're willing if Ricky's willing to use his celebrity profile for the sake of the show, I'm willing to look like a, you know, let's say a fairly handsome, kind of cool customer. I think at least, the very least, Karl, is that you appear on there as well. Yeah. You could dress up
Are you worried that you'll look the worst out of all three of us?
Who am I standing next to? Am I next to Steve? I'm fairly confident.
Yeah. I like the way it's so predictable. You pull the string because you know what it is. It's
you pull the string.
I'm Ricky Gervais. With me, Steve Merchant and Karl Pilkington. Still arguing, this time about having help from your mum and dad. What do you think, Karl?
No, I'm not. I don't want this to turn into some sort of wacky type thing where we're pretending we're arguing.
Yeah.
Well, we're not pretending.
We're not pretending. You are arguing.
Yeah, I know what people will think we're messing about.
Oh, right? I wouldn't have thought so.
We just need to. We can talk about it later. Sort it out.
Hmm. Yeah. It's just that Carl's a little bit stressed.
I'm not stressed, but.
And he doesn't really understand that, you know. You know, me and Steve have got lots of different jobs in the week. He's just got one job.
Yeah. But and we sort of rely on people getting messages to us, you know, as soon as they get them, you know, and not sort of deleting them from their phone selfishly. Yeah. Just things like that, you know, people being on the ball. Not just thinking about themselves all the time, not just thinking about number one.
What do you think, Karl?
Whatever. Do you know what I mean? Whatever.
Don't get all maudlin again. Just having a little discussion. Yeah, this will annoy you. Guess what? Think of this, you little slaphead twat. Apparently, that's sewn his arse. Right, apparently, women can get bald treatment on the National Health Service, but men can't. What do you think of that? Do you think that's fair?
Is that a fact?
It's a fact.
We should point out that Karl is, would you say balding?
Yeah.
Would that be fair?
Well, either that or a wide parting.
Oh, you know,
rubbish. That's rubbish, Karl, those prizes. I'm ashamed to give them away.
Karl, you know our mate Johnny? He's a Doctor Who fan.
Yeah.
Do you remember, he bought, the Doctor Who magazine, and, he went, to the toilet, and Steve got post-it notes and put geek on every page. And Johnny opened it on the tube, right, and it had geek and everything. And Johnny bought in the new Doctor Who magazine, I think this week's or this month's, right? And they've done the perfect Doctor Who fan. Right, what the geek is, right, and it looks exactly like Steve.
Alright, don't have a go, really.
It does. And I'm gonna try and put it on the website. It's amazing. It's got your hair, glasses, it stands like you, it's sort of dressed like you, and it's only, it's hilarious, and I'm insulting you now. It sounds like an insult, but if you'd see it, you'd laugh. Player.
Well, Rockbusters, right?
Yeah.
Right, here we go.
Just a little bit annoyed.
Just, three clues.
I'm just reading out the clues.
Should we put this? Let's put this one in for the Sony Award. Let's put this show in for the Sony Award.
Play a song, Karl, because I need to discuss things with him. I've talked before about in
second it down. Off. Get this down to 3 minutes. It'd be a great show.
Rockbusters in a minute. XFM.
I tell you, you're going to go along later to the Live 8 gig and you're probably going to see some bands that are going to make an effort to entertain you, but oh, if you want entertainment, Rick, you know it.
Go on.
There's only one person to book.
Go on.
Me. I'm obviously a top DJ on the radio, but where I really come into my own is DJing in any kind of club environment.
Well, you told me you were DJing, I didn't go to it, DJing at a party, and you said the place was rocking.
The place was roaring.
And I loved it. Karl just said he was there and they weren't.
Well, that's nonsense, Karl, because you know very well that when I'd put on a tune, they'd cheer.
Yeah, but it was late on in the night, they would have done that whatever you put on.
That's nonsense.
No, they were happy and everything. I'm not saying they were having a good time. It was your party. It was all right, but they weren't going mental like you're sort of making up.
They were definitely going mental. Nah, when I put on the Proclaimers, they could not believe their luck. they would have walked 1,000 miles.
Was it good though? Were they dancing, were they?
It's dancing and that, but they weren't sort of cheering, going, you know, more and all that at the end.
What's about?
Oh,
Take
wow.
On Me came on, the big, big cheer went up.
Oh, I don't know who to believe.
I've been there, done it, Steve. I've been the DJ as well.
It might be jealousy. I think it's professional jealousy there.
I think it's because my fortunes are on the up, and these are on the down. You know, we all know famously that he had Pilkington's making music, his DJ outfit.
Didn't happen.
I did enough. I just wanted to do enough to pay for the equipment. And I did. And that was that. But I don't like crowds, do I? It's one of them things, isn't it? Like I've said before, when you first see something, it's a bit of a shock. Do you know what I mean? It's like, the Elephant Man or whatever.
Yeah.
First time you see him, it's that sort of, oh, look at that.
Yeah. Do you remember the first time you saw Steve? No, I'm not being funny. Do you remember the first?
Yeah, but I've said this before. It's always then you get used to how people look and you don't. No, no.
I'm gonna burst. You have to play a record.
No, but
because that's Steve's.
Who's the winner?
The winner, very lucky, Sandra Cassidy of Leon C. She gets all those great prizes. You know, we've actually had people emailing in saying this is the worst Rockbusters ever because it was too easy, it was boring.
Oh. But,
this is just, don't shoot the messenger.
Oh,
other
dear.
People saying it really has run its course. Some people genuinely agree with Ricky.
Oh, Carl, this must hurt, mate.
Stinging attacks on you. Some people just slagging you off generally, saying you whinge all the time.
Looks like Steve was right when he sort of like poo-poos your ideas.
So
when he wheeze on your bonfire.
Someone else, like, swear to God, someone else emailed in and said, don't bother sending me the prizes, take them to a charity shop or pawn them, give me the money, I'd rather have it. So I don't know what to say, Carl. I just wonder if it really has run its course now.
Alright, well, we'll see what you come up with next week. Well. let's see what you do, let's see what you come in with.
Sure.
Yeah. About 5-1. I'm guessing you'll be popping in with another hip hop track full of effing and jeffing.
Well, I won't bring it into you. I'll do it myself at home. Obviously, that makes it easier.
Oh,
obviously,
dear.
You can't cope.
Oh dear.
Are you actually going to be here next week, or are you still going to be in Cornwall?
No, you see, there again. I'll be back. I'll be back in time. And in the week when I go to, you know, Cornwall to see the Monkey World.
Yeah, your 2-day pass to Monkey World.
That still works.
Yeah.
What?
But you're going to interview some of the monkeys? Get some stories.
That. I love that. You were going, could a monkey live without bones? And so I'm going, Carl, shut the please, just look at the monkeys and eat your ice cream. And that's work, is it?
What?
Anyway, that's all I wanted to say, really.
It is tragic.
What's tragic?
What did you want me to say about that song?
Just your opinion. Your own opinion was fine. In fact, your own opinion is better than anything I could really hope for. Without doubt. Whenever I ask you a question,
you constantly surprise us.
Yeah. It's wonderful. So only ever carry on telling the truth, carry on saying exactly what's on your mind, and I think this could become a great.
You're like a man who was frozen in Victorian era and has been reawoken and he's kind of discovering the world. Some things make sense, other things don't. It's beautiful. It's
as opposed to one that was made in a castle in Victorian times like Steve.
Oh, that's just.
Oh, I've joined in with Carl.
I can't believe it. I'm
sorry.
On my side.
Yeah, no, it was irresistible though, wasn't it? Mm. I'm really sorry. Should we play a record?
I mean, I know what Steve's like. He is tight, right? He is. And you know that, don't you, Steve?
Financially,
I
mean, you mean?
Well, no, I mean just the way you are. You're very sort of, you know, you're not wasteful with your money.
I'm careful. No, I'm not wasteful. Absolutely right.
No, no, but to the extreme.
Not at all to the extreme. Not towards the extreme.
No.
Look after the pennies, the pounds will take care of themselves. Alright? Simple to remember, good advice.
Yeah,
alright?
But the thing is, right, I know that I take the mickey out of you for, like, you know, the way you look and stuff.
Sure. Right? Well, I'm right back at you.
But the thing is, you can't help that.
Absolutely.
But I'll tell you something that women don't like.
Sure.
And it's fellas who are tight with the money.
Sure. I'm not frugal with money with ladies. I'm frugal with money with you.
Well,
I've got no reason to splash money out on you.
I've never seen you splash money out.
Well, you've never been out with me.
Steve, have you ever splashed out on a lady?
No, but I hope to one day. The right lady.
Play a record.
See? Strokes. Someday. Now, that was a better choice, wouldn't it, to start off with? Oh, hello, ladies and gentlemen. XFM 104.9. I'm Ricky Gervais, obviously. Steve Mitchell.
Now, come on, let's get my name right from now on. That novelty's worn off.
What is it? Is it
Steve Merchant?
Oh, yeah, that's the wrong one, isn't it, Mitchell?
The Guardian got it wrong, it's Steve Merchant.
And the more I say Mitchell, the more people are thinking
exactly, might be Mitchell.
It might be Mitchell. Oh, God, sorry, Dave. but Carl wanted to start off with the Stereophonics.
Oh, loser.
Because it was a newer track. And Carl now, we've made him what he is. He was nothing when
nobody.
We found him.
He's right? Like work experience.
And now he's going, oh, we should start off with the Stereophonics. I'm going,
trying to tell you what to do, Ricky.
If I want anyone's opinion, I don't. Basically.
But you'd probably come to me, I imagine, wouldn't you? I'd be the first person.
Before Carl, yeah. I'd consult you, Steve.
Thank you.
Just keep it, just because he was in a, was it Pilkey's
his
making
mobile disc
music?
Drive,
I cannot wait.
I'm looking forward to this.
I mean, I literally can't wait. Should we do it now?
Well, I'm tempted to save it because I just want to mention to people that they should be very excited. Because it's going to be Carl's special night tomorrow.
You excited, Karl?
Oh, yeah. Oh, this is, yeah, me and Steve, because we were nominated, we get a guest.
For the BAFTA Awards.
And it's, it doesn't say guest, it actually says, you know, partner. So I'm taking, my partner. And, Steve's taking Karl.
Yeah.
But what Karl doesn't realise is, you will have to pretend you're his partner, otherwise you wouldn't be able to-
Yeah, we'll have to hold hands when you've got the red carpet.
Is this your, is this really your partner? It's not just a guest. They
have That's
to,
how it is. And either we go in like that or we can't get in.
You have to, you just have to be with him when you go up there. I mean, you have to, does
yeah,
he have to
hold- we should hold hands, but I think what we should do is just to make sure that there's nothing at all that, like, it's gonna go wrong, we should just do a little kiss.
Just like, and or be seen sort of like cheek to cheek, just to show them that, you know, you're not- he's
like
not
Elton John and David
He's not just getting his mates in for a free meal, you are actually partners.
No, I'm not up for that.
Why not?
Well,
because we know we're not actually gay.
No, but yeah, but
so it's not a problem.
You've come out of it looking quite good because you've got a good-looking fella. But I'm meant to look like, you know. I mean, I'm not gay, but if I was, I don't think I'd go for your thing.
Oh, he's done you, Steve! It's turned on you again!
I cannot believe
we were trying to get him.
Wait a minute. Sure. I have got the cream of London's totty phoning me up trying to get an invite to the BAFTAs.
Yeah.
Right. We have very graciously asked you if you would like to come along.
Well, that worries me even more, that you've got women calling you up.
Karl.
Karl, I can't choose between them. If I let one of them down, I'm gonna, they're gonna destroy them. They'll be ruined, their lives will be ruined. It's better for me to take you and not, you know, ruin the lives of any of those poor
women. When he told them he was taking you, it was like a scene from Graceland. There was just like-
There was weeping.
They were crying. Like
it was horrible.
Hundreds of them, and he just went. And
I got upset.
He just had to say, "Look, just chill out, bitches," didn't you?
I did. I just said, "You know, you're all my hoes, but I can't choose between you."
So I'm taking Karl.
So I'm taking Karl.
You know, he could get you a discount frocks.
No, I had a letter from the people that there's a
organization.
No, listen, Karl. There's an organization that sponsors the BAFTA Awards in terms of clothes and fashion. They sent me a letter. They said your partner. They've not specified the sex. They've said your partner can come along and choose an outfit. Now I suspect. By the look of it, it is a woman's outfitters. I'm thinking we could get you a lovely trouser suit.
Well, you have
it may look feminine, right? But I think people will be fooled.
It'd just be a little bit roomy in the hip and probably narrow on the shoulders, but you're a bit skinny. Why don't you take it? Because it's a lot of an insult.
And maybe just some pearls as well. Be lovely.
Wouldn't you?
I haven't got anything sorted to wear yet.
See, you're slagging me off. You're likely to end up going in a tracksuit.
But yeah, I don't know what we're talking about there. So we've got the film thing going.
I don't know what we were talking about. What were you talking about earlier about glasses as well and Steve taking his glasses off? What was that?
What are you saying that in front of him now for?
Was it an insult?
It wasn't really an insult.
Karl, what were you up to?
No, what was it? I genuinely don't remember. I genuinely don't remember.
Well, right, Steve, I'm not having a go. Right? Just saying our people, it's a bit weird that you've got glasses because you've got a good pair of eyes on you. Right? That isn't an insult.
What were you talking about though? What was it? Why did
it was the fact that people who wear glasses always look a bit weird without them on. It's like, you know, they should wear glasses.
Okay. Why did we get round to this? What was we talking about?
I don't know what that was.
It sounds like an insult, even it wasn't intended as one.
It wasn't.
It sounds like an insult, Karl.
It does, yeah.
No, it wasn't.
I should be allowed to punch you every time you insult me, no?
No, but I'm not.
I'm doing it. I'm going to give you a dead arm.
Look, Steve, it's you.
Even if it wasn't, you intended it to be one.
What you.
Oh! That was real. Play a record.
Yeah, but.
It's mad.
That's mad.
Is this the Cardigans? Great. Brilliant.
I didn't even say anything.
It makes me feel better. It makes me feel better. I can enjoy the rest of the show. You went in, there was George Best, one of your footballing heroes was there, a load of other big names. You sat there, you had prime position, you came backstage with a load of other big names. Hey, you had a lovely bit of grub.
You were filming this thing for the DVD we're making, that's you, a cameraman on our DVD. And yet you think, oh, and now you look grumpy because you had a couple of pints and you, oh, I can't believe
it. So tell us why you didn't enjoy it, because the ceremony, what didn't you enjoy about that? It was interminable, wasn't it?
Far too long.
Wasn't it awful?
Three boring. Hours.
I'm sorry. I thought you were going to say something.
Really?
Sorry.
3 hours.
Yeah.
I mean, I suppose for you two, at least, you know, you were going to get something.
Sure.
Yeah.
But with me, it's like, I mean, I've never graduated or anything, so
Have you not?
I'm trying to think of a situation. Basically, I sat there 3 hours knowing that I'm not going to get anything out of the night.
Yeah.
Right. Now.
No, did you, sorry, when we invited you and you said yes, did you think you were up for an award?
No. I thought we were going to be sat round tables, having a nice bit of food, whilst people are going up there winning awards.
Yeah.
But 3 hours of the same thing over and over again. I mean, if a film's 3 hours in the cinema, you go, well, it's long, but, you know, I wonder how it's going to end.
Yeah.
But this was just like the same thing over and over again. Some guy going up, thanks a lot, cheers for the bit of brass. And then going down, sitting down, the same thing over and over again.
Mm.
I'd say it was one of the worst things I've ever had to do.
I
enjoyed the night afterwards when we did have a bit of lamb and a nice bit of veg and that. That was alright, and I went home and I was happy, and I got the little freebie bag that you're talking about that we gave away.
Yeah.
Which wasn't much good stuff in it.
Oh,
alright!
No,
what would you have done on that Saturday night?
Suzanne,
what would you have done if, or the Sunday night rather, what would you have done had you been at home?
I would have stayed in with Suzanne, right, watching telly, having a nice bit of pate on toast or something, cup of tea, watching 24, but instead, I had to buy an expensive suit so I didn't show you up, right?
And what did you spend on your suit?
Well, in total, right, because, you know, the shoes and the suit and the shirt and the tie, it was about 600 quid.
That's the most expensive evening ever.
And that's what I'm saying to you. And the daft thing is, it's dark in there. I don't know why you've got to wear a nice suit.
You can't wear a tracksuit, for goodness sake.
It's dark in there.
Just the shirt and that. It doesn't make you a better person wearing a suit.
No, doesn't make you a better person.
We're not claiming it made you a better person.
No, well, that annoyed me.
Yeah.
I mean, it was an experience, isn't it? That's why I went, because you think, if I didn't go, if I would have said to you when you invited me, no, Steve, I don't want to go, then I would have never known, right?
Yeah.
And that's my sort of thing in life, right?
Yeah.
If
something
comes up, you should take it, even if you're not going to like it, it's a bit of an experience.
Right.
Do you know what he said to me? I phoned him up because we had to meet up, and obviously he had to pose as my, gay lover.
Yeah.
To get in, right?
Yeah.
He phoned me, what do you said something to me like, I bought a suit, I'm looking good. He said, I'm looking good. People will think, how on earth did he end up with that good looking guy?
So he got into the role.
That was what he said to me.
Started getting into it.
Such an insult.
Fire record.
Oh, dear. So just go back to insults briefly.
Go on.
You know, saying.
Goofy, that's not fair. Because that's what he said. It's in the head.
What do you mean he said?
No,
when did he say that?
No, I mean.
When did you call me goofy?
No, he didn't. He said about
Baldy?
Once in the head.
Hey,
no,
when it's
come off it. Don't
what?
Start
who's calling me goofy?
No,
I'm not even goofy. Goggle eyed, fair enough.
No, yeah, but you can sort your look out. I can't.
What do you mean I can? How can I sort my look out? I'm not even goofy. You've that's not fair.
You've got the proper features.
What?
Just need sorting out a bit. I can't help it if my hair's not good.
Do you know what I mean? It's brilliant. I'd like to rent you out to people.
See me, I'm different. I would happily leave him now in the bottom of the cupboard.
Until quiz night.
With the Scare Electrics.
Until the old pub quiz night, when there's no one else who will have you on the team.
Sure.
And suddenly you want to be your best mate.
Done him again!
Right?
Yeah, where's his mum and dad then, Karl?
Mm.
Yeah?
In Bristol.
Yeah.
Me and Steve were having a little meeting yesterday over lunch about, you know, planning stuff for the show. And, Gary Kemp came up to me, started having a little chat about old times, and, I went, oh, yeah. As he went away, Steve said, right, think of this. He said, Rick, don't take this the wrong way. Remember that sentence, don't take this the wrong way. So there's a right way and a wrong way I could have taken this comment. He went, nodded to sort of Gary Kemp and went, he's aged better than you. I went, well, how could I take that the wrong way?
Yeah, it's not offensive.
No. Well, the point is this. He didn't know me 20 years ago, so he's actually saying, Rick, don't take this the wrong way, he looks better than you do.
Yeah, well, he does.
But why say that, Karl?
What? Did you really say that?
Yeah, although, can I just backtrack him for a second? I love the fact you said you bumped into Gary Kemp and you reminisced about old times. What old times did you share with Gary Kemp?
Well, no, he came up and said, did we drop the pops together? I went, no, I did razzmatazz. He said, oh, we did razzmatazz. I think he was thinking, had he ever met me before? But he hadn't, because we hadn't. That's what I meant.
Yeah.
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 And,
but if you had to make an objective analysis, you know.
I wouldn't. I think that's out of order.
Sure. Sure. I mean, you're always slagging me off, but apparently you can't make a value judgment on something else. No.
Wouldn't do that.
Well, because you're morally all over the place. You don't know where you're coming or going.
Believe it.
Sure. You should hear what I say about you behind your back.
So, would you say you're better looking now than you were?
or
than I'm what?
Would you say you're better looking now than you were?
Than I was when?
Well, like you know, have you aged well?
Yes.
You've aged well.
Yeah, I've kept my looks.
Yeah. Bit of Dando.
Bit Evan Dando. This would be lovely. Yes. Look for sunshine.
I'm not going. At the moment, I'm not going. And I'm desperate to see him, man. I mean, he's, you know, he's going to do a great concert. It's his only one in London. I can't believe that being on the radio, being on XFM, you know, the listenership's going up, apparently. I can't believe I can't get a ticket. I've asked Karl. He's done nothing. He's done nothing.
No, Karl had a very good point.
Nothing.
Karl, tell what you said when he was whinging in the
break. First of all, whilst you're moaning, you also asked in the week for a Badly Drawn Boy album.
Yeah.
You got in today.
Yeah.
There's one there for you.
Well, yeah, but it's yin and yang.
And it's like, yeah, but I don't, you know.
Karl, what's Steve ever done for you? That's what you got to ask yourself. What has Steve ever done for you?
Well, he took me to the BAFTAs. Yeah, but only because no one else would probably want to go with you.
I can't believe that.
What is this?
I do not believe that. Oh, Steve, I'm going to stitch you up now, Karl. And it's in a nice way. And don't worry, it won't be too bad. He won't take too bad. Karl sent me a little text message today.
Right. What is this?
Okay.
You know, I'm in a very frail mood at the moment.
No, you're like this, Bruce. This is funny because me and him have been like sending trivia back and forth to each other, which is another point, right? I sent him. Oh well, I'll get to that in a minute. I thought he'd really be amazed with
Well, while you're fiddling, if you can make my dream come true to go and see Bruce Springsteen tomorrow, then give us a call on the usual number.
Yeah, but like I said, Steve.
What?
Right? It wouldn't be right. You just said when the song was on, can't believe it, right? We work at XFM and I can't get tickets for Springsteen, right? Yeah. We work in radio, we should get tickets. Mm. Right now, think
which
of
I'm willing to pay for.
Yeah, but think of the but if it's sold out, it's sold out.
Yeah,
right? Yeah, but that's just something they say.
Right, that's just what they say, is it? Right, so everybody on local radio stations say, do you know, I like that Bruce Springsteen, I want a free ticket. Right? So another say-
I tried to phone, I phoned for an hour and a half, I couldn't get through.
Not long enough.
I put the hours in.
Not long enough.
Not long enough.
What are you talking about? Put the hours in.
No.
Right? So another 400 people turn up at the gig, they cram them all in, there's people being crushed, you know, they've paid the money early, they were up early that day when the phone lines were open, whilst you were probably sleeping and that. So they're dedicated and they're the ones at the front getting crushed.
What?
Would you mind that be crushed? Happy if you were there getting crushed?
I don't mind. I'll sit at the side of the stage and watch him.
Yeah, but
I don't mind.
But everyone will say that then. And then before you know it, no one can see anything because you're
Karl's
all on the
Right, I'm gonna give you this here. I'm handing over my mobile phone to Steve to read the you can see it's from Karl at the top, but just read it out as you scroll down. Just read it out loud.
Is this a text message from
This is a text message to me from Karl. Read it out.
To see at night as well as an owl. You would need eyes the size of grapefruits. If only Stephen could turn his head right round as well. Karl, I can't believe it. What upsets me most, Karl, right, is not the fact that you've been slagging me off behind my back. It's the fact that you've got the cheek to come on here and moralise because you failed to get me tickets and make a dream come true. You've come on here trying to pass the buck and say that it's a health and safety problem, when in actual fact, it's a Karl Pilkington problem.
Do that, I've got it in a bin.
I'm devastated, you know.
I didn't, let's play a record.
I'm upset.
I should have eaten this banana.
What's the number?
It's 08700 800 1234. But if it's sold out, Steve, it's sold out.
A bit of a classic, eh? REM.
I bet if Ricky wanted to go, it'd be fine. I'm sure someone could sort it out then.
Who?
Oh, if Ricky Gervais wants to go, then
I'm going.
Come. Are you?
No.
You want some tickets, then?
Yeah. Well, there's the best band in Britain, in my opinion.
Big words.
The Darkness, Growing on Me. On XFM 104.9, I'm Ricky Gervais with me, Steve Merchant, and Karl Pilkington.
Have you got the album?
And already, they've had an argument.
Yes. Well, I mean, I don't know whether we need to cheapen the show by discussing it, but I asked for a particular track. Karl is the producer, and he failed to get it for me. He's failed to bring it up from the record library. Completely failed in his mission. He needed to get two records, and he failed to get one of them. A 50% error rate there.
Yeah, but like I said, I looked in the system, it told me what album it's on, I brought that album up. I'm busy.
But, okay, so fine, you're absolutely fine then, that's no problem. You know, that's a great excuse, Karl, brilliant. The show has been ruined, it's been partially ruined, but you've got a bit of an excuse.
Alright, I didn't make a big deal out of it when you said, oh, and whilst you're down there, get us a new 50 Cent single.
I never said, why are you down there, get the new 50 Cent single. I asked you if 50 Cent single was lying around. If it hadn't been here, I wouldn't have worried.
So I get it, yeah, I did that for you.
Right. Come what you say, has it got swearing in it? Well, what? I don't know. It's 5 to 1, Steve. Yeah, the producer! I've been
yeah, the around. Producer! It's the brand new single. I thought it would be lying around in the XFM office anyway.
But I don't have time to sit around listening to music.
Sure. Well, yeah.
Right? I know that you have. Now you've got an iPod that can hold 7,500 songs. I don't know when you're going to get round to loading all them on, but I haven't got the time.
Sure.
Busy.
Yeah. Fine, okay. No, that's a perfect excuse, Karl. Well done, mate. I just hope that I never have to depend on you in a real emergency.
Yeah. So, we were talking about press replay records. Is that link too long already actually got to something?
I'm already bored.
Karl, we've got to get to something. We've got to do something.
Why don't you contribute something? You've been silent.
Now, that is scraping the bottom of the barrel. Like, we're in trouble. Oh, no. Oh, we're failing. Who can we bring on that surefire always delivers
audio snappy dynamite?
Yeah. Karl!
The big guns.
Come on, Karl.
I was just thinking, there is nobody else who looks like Steve.
He's done ya.
That's outrageous. Although, to be honest with you, that insult has resurrected things.
Yeah, well done.
And I was on my mobile phone, and I was chatting away to someone, and, what can only be described as a prostitute.
Go on.
Stood on the street corner.
Was she a woman that gives you sex for money?
Yes.
That is a prostitute.
Yes, that's what I thought.
Go on.
And as I was walking by, she said, do you want to buy sex?
What a place.
Now,
you sure it wasn't a market trader giving six plums away?
No, it was definitely
six for a quid.
No, it was definitely a prostitute.
Yeah.
And what annoyed me about it, what I wanted to pick her up on something, was the fact that I was on my mobile phone. It's like, can you imagine?
She was rude.
Who would I? What am I going to hang up? Sorry, Mum. Can I call you back?
I've
you know, you say you want me to meet more women,
and you know you sent me that 30 quid
exactly
for my birthday.
Yeah, yeah. Sorry, Mr. Johnson. I'm really excited about the job. Can I call you back? I'm just going to negotiate with a whore. And it was just you could tell that she was clearly probably desperate for crack or a latest fix or smack. So she was literally the normal etiquette of prostitution, you know, that they hang around, they show some thigh. I've seen this in films.
Will,
yeah. Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
Take you out for a meal, that sort of thing. That had sort of gone out of the window, and
yeah,
she was just there, desperate, running around.
Did
the
she go out of
the
window?
Like,
because that's another thing they sometimes do, specialist ones.
But I was shocked because I've never been propositioned before like that.
Really?
In London.
That's weird, isn't it? Karl, thoughts?
I think you'd be sort of approached a lot because they tend to sort of go for people who look like they haven't got much chance.
Sure.
And I'm not being mean.
No. Sorry, I'll let you go back to it. In what way aren't you being mean? By saying that Steve's
nose is a little bit odd looking.
I don't think. Well.
No, he does. Do you know?
No, but it's not whether what he thinks of his looks, it's what he thinks of you. Talking about his looks on
no, but it's like how you were talking before about, you know, your eyes are bad. It's nature's little way of saying, look, nothing to see here, right?
Don't get that.
I don't know what you mean.
When you look in the mirror and that, they've gone, look, he hasn't got the looks. Let's make his eyes bad, right?
Yeah.
Nothing to see here.
Yeah.
That's what I'm saying.
See,
balancing it out, right?
Yeah.
And it's funny, right? Now we're on the topic.
Sorry, right, Johnny Depp.
No, listen,
but. My chest is gonna burst at this
but
moment.
Whenever we go into this conversation, I always think to myself, Karl, do you know what you look like?
I'm gonna
burst. You know, seriously, can I be honest with you? You look like, you know, if you've got like a balloon, a hot air balloon, right? Just a little balloon, like a party balloon. Right. If you drew a little face on it, right, and inflated it about halfway, that's what you look like.
Right.
No, play a record. No, I don't want to get into this. It's too intense.
Now you've got onto this. Let's just nip it in the bud now. I'll tell you something that I wasn't going to tell you because I think it was
I don't want to hear it.
Right, it was on the tube. Right. Well, I was. Someone told me they were on the tube. Mm. Right. And the tube pulled into a station. Right? And one of the women saw the poster that's out at the moment with you and Rick on it. Right.
Yeah.
So this woman apparently goes, it's Ricky. Ricky's on the radio. Right, and the other woman goes, "Oh yeah, don't you listen to it?" So she goes, "Oh, I didn't know it was on the radio," and she goes, "Oh,
I'm sorry, Steve.
Look,
because he didn't sound this bad."
She said, "Oh, look at that person he's with." So she goes, "Yeah." She said, "That's Steve." She said, "I was sort of aware that he looked odd because Karl mentions it on the radio."
Yeah.
So it wasn't as much of a blow to me, but I can see how it was a bit of a shock to you.
Yeah.
So that's weird, isn't it?
Yeah.
And that isn't me sort of telling this woman to say anything, that was all happened without anybody else sort of bringing it on.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So.
Was it? Sorry, you seem to be relishing this. Was it because of the little balloon story that made you?
I honestly, Steve, I wouldn't have told you, but if you're gonna start, you know, having a pop.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? I can't just sit here and take sure. it and that.
No, no. I mean, yeah. all mates.
Yeah, it's just,
yeah. Well, I mean, I was mistaken for Johnny Vegas. Steve's got a story about that, if you wanna have a go at me.
Well, you'd know someone just thought you were fat with a beard, which is true.
Well, don't have a go at me, because he said you looked-
Well, you started it.
No, I didn't. Yeah, no, I didn't.
You were milking it. You were egging him on.
I was laughing.
You were egging him on.
I sort of was.
Yeah.
But let's not, you know.
Oh, it's a good job you've got lots of good mates like Jonathan Ross, who you can go and hang out with. Don't need other friends, people who've helped you in your career.
Because actors are often quite handsome people, but yet they're always quite obnoxious.
Yeah, we are.
No, I mean, they're normally quite obnoxious, Rick. Again, you know, you're a good example of that. And yet, I think it must be the small man complex. That's what makes them so obnoxious and so kind of desperate for attention. Didn't realise it before.
Steady on.
Because, of course, I tower above everyone.
You do, don't you?
I'm, for people who don't know, who are listening, I'm 6'7" tall. That's high.
Yeah.
That's
And for people who've never seen him, he doesn't hold it well. It's not like he's a sort of handsome athlete, is it, Karl? He's a bit of a, what do you call him?
Karl, don't answer
him. No.
Don't get drawn into that. You know the game he's playing.
No. Do you know yesterday when you were in the office?
Yeah.
You did a little move, and it reminded me of Blakey.
I hate you, Gervais. Oh, I hate you, Pilkington.
That's his stance.
Yeah, but even he held it a little bit better, didn't he? Because he was a man, you know, yeah. He had a big coat and everything, and a peaked cap. But, yeah.
I can't believe you. Like, I've not suffered enough from being freakishly tall. Now, two of my best buddies live on radio are just-
It's not just the height, though, is it? It's the posture and the face and everything.
But it's got your places, hasn't it?
No.
What do you mean it's got me places?
I think people give you a bit more of a chance in your career and stuff, because it's like...
Well, yeah, stacking shelves. Because I can reach to a high level.
Mr. Wilkinson, hello, it's Dr. Hanrahan. Barry Sheen has just passed away, and you go, oh dear. Bad news and good news. Do you want his face, or do you want his face?
Does Suzanne go out with you, like, for charitable reasons?
I love the fact that she encourages you.
She was saying about Tom Cruise, and I was like, oh. You know, she said, you know, he's not a bad-looking fella or whatever.
So, well, what she's saying is, Karl, is there any chance you could go and get a different face? Maybe something like Tom Cruise would be good.
Yeah, but then I was saying, right, first of all, he's got to be dead and he's not. But if he was, and you had that done, would you feel like...
People were looking at you on the tube.
Well, no, like, say if the people who made Mission Impossible said, well, we want to do a third one. would I be in my right to say, well, I don't want to do it?
I don't know what he's talking about.
I don't mean to be offensive, Karl, but your girlfriend could do a lot better than you. I don't know what you're thinking.
I love the idea of this whole conversation about you in Tom Cruise's face and then get offered a film.
But why does she have conversations like this with you?
It was now on last night. It's now on the telly.
I love it. What should we talk about? What about getting a new face? Oh dear. That cartoon. If you don't know what Karl looks like, there's a cartoon that was in last week's Heat, isn't it, that I drew on the website. What's it going for now? Bid?
I think it's at about, £225 at the moment.
And what do they have to do to bid for it?
Just email in and I'll pass it on to the website people.
I know why Heat put it in. It's because the editor, Boyd Hilton, looks a little bit like you, doesn't he?
Sort of my ugly brother.
Listening and he says nice things about you.
Yeah, he can still say nice things, but I bet he knows deep down. You know if you're good looking or not, don't you?
I can't believe
Come
it,
on, Steve. I mean, what
it's
do you
going,
think?
This is going crazy now, Karl. I don't know. You're just, the insults are flying left, right, and center. You've got no limits. You've just gone crazy. You've just gone wild. You're swanning around just because you look like Tom Cruise.
I think it's because he's been hanging out with Christian O'Connell.
Yeah.
And they're both thinking, yeah.
A couple of media players.
Yeah.
Too big for their boots.
Yeah, not scared. Although he's scared of Christian.
No, he's terrible.
He's scared of Christian in here because he's not allowed to do monkey news.
No.
Because
yeah.
Christian wants to do it. He's scared of him.
I'm not saying that, right? Christian.
I'm not trying to do monkey news, but Christian wants to do some monkey news. I'm lot of language. What star sign are you?
Mine changes. I'm on the edge.
Oh, right. God. Okay.
He even makes that complicated.
Of course.
He even makes twaddle complicated.
No, I'm just, it changes depending what paper you read.
Yeah. Alright, in theory.
23rd of September. So I think most of the time I'm a Virgo, I think. Oh.
Well, I'll tell you.
Write that down, listeners. 23rd of September. And come round and give him the bumps.
What I mean?
Well, according to this, I mean, you've been criticising this, Rick.
Sure.
You've been saying that there's maybe not anything in the zodiac.
Yeah, yeah,
well, hang on, let me just read something.
Is this going to change my mind? Well, am I going to eat my words?
The typical Virgoan.
Words.
Okay. The physical appearance of the typical Virgoan.
Yeah.
High forehead.
That's not true.
Cranium may seem too big in comparison with the face. Look at Karl.
But how specific is that?
Has an extremely large forehead. Has a high hairline.
That's not true though, is it?
Maybe quite tall.
What are the blokes like?
Often has one foot turned in more than the other.
What do they've just described Rain Man. What is that? How can I be specific?
Well, that's why it sounds like Karl.
One foot turned in.
Yeah.
Oh.
Well, have they even bothered doing one for you? Because there isn't many people who...
Hang on a minute.
Let him finish, Steve.
No, I'm just saying.
Go on. What are you saying?
I sort of think I'm fairly average looking, but I'm saying, have they wasted a page in that book for whatever you are?
It started off me being dissing him and stuff, and you've been nice.
Hang on a minute. I don't think you can be a Virgoan, because it says, that they are normally quick, alert and intelligent. But no, actually, I have to say, it says here, behaviour and personality traits of the Virgoan, is an excellent mimic, can learn many things in a short time. Not really true of you, is it?
Rarely questions
authority, but frequently questions facts. You never question facts.
Yeah, you never question authority, he's scared of authority.
Yeah. You're usually trying to very, very upset if teased. That's true.
Yeah, oh yeah.
Hang on a minute though.
Yeah. Can't take a bit of stick, too much pressure. If you can't stand the heat, get out of the kitchen. Yeah.
What to teach a young Virgoan? Myths, fairy stories, make-believe, daydreams, and how to use imagination should all be taught to young Virgoan, so they have plenty of magical moments to remember in their adult years when they are often alone.
I'm changing my mind.
I know.
This is good stuff. So, this is really good stuff.
All right, well, let's see. What are you?
I don't think we should talk about that.
Yeah, let's have a look.
It says the Virgoan is- I love some of the specifics of this. Virgoan is an employer. He's excellent as the boss of a small company.
Yeah. Don't give him on a Tuesday. He's probably stamp collecting then.
Yeah.
He loves a bit of haddock.
Okay, let me look at mine.
Oh, that is good though, Karl, isn't it? That is you all over. I've changed my mind. It's brilliant. It's a real science. They've really put their work in with this one.
Let me see, Sagittarius, Sarah Jones, Sagittarian is a happy, playful little clown.
Little.
Greets everyone.
Oh dear. Yeah.
Let me see, Sagittarius at home.
He's only gonna read the good bits though, isn't he?
Yeah, exactly.
If that's it, what can it say?
Have they done yours in sort of small print, because you've got special eyes?
I don't know what that insult is, Karl. What kind of an insult is that?
Well...
He's happy with that! Look at his face!
He's done me.
Oh, dear. And come back
to me. To a certain extent.
I'm just thinking, if I was to meet Steve in a restaurant...
Yeah.
Right,
nothing untoward going on, we're just hanging out. We're
just having a chat, having a normal night out.
Yeah. Who's paying? Because, I mean, is it expensive?
Go Dutch. I mean...
Right, so... I say to you, I'll see you at 8. Right, in this restaurant. I turn up at the door, it's a bit of a posh place, right? So he's Steve Merchant in.
Yeah.
And the waiter sort of goes, I don't know, what does he look like, right? And,
where's he from?
Just a little French fella.
Oh yeah.
And, what does he look like? So I'd, the thing I'd pick up on first, tall lad.
Tall, yeah.
And then he goes, oh, well, you know, we got lots of tall people in, right? Yeah. And I go, big eyes?
Big eyes.
Yeah. And then he'd go, yeah, he's over there.
I'll be honest with you. I mean, you can have dinner and you can buy me dinner. I'm not sure you're going to get anywhere with me.
Yeah, but the thing is, what he hasn't said is, well, he gets frustrated because we have to go from restaurant to restaurant for something I can eat. But the reason we've only got about 3 restaurants to choose from are that, because he doesn't want to spend more than a fiver at lunchtime.
At lunchtime? Mm. If I was going out of an evening, you'd spend a decent amount of wallop. But lunchtime, would you? You'd be happy to spend 20 quid on lunch. Imagine that every single day. There's no one out there who's eating lunch 20 quid a day on lunch. It's crazy. You don't need that much food at lunchtime. Because I know what happens. You go in there, you have some kind of, you know, Thai green curry for lunch. You're asleep by 1:30. We're trying to work, we're trying to write TV shows. And you're dozing off like one of those giant anacondas that's just eating a sheep. And it's slowly digesting it. It takes like 3 weeks.
He'll walk a mile out of his way to get a sandwich for
having an argument over that 50p that time.
Here's the situation, Karl. I lent you 50p, and you decided you weren't going to pay me back. It should be to my discretion if I say, don't worry about it, Karl. You should offer me the 50p, go, there's that 50p I owe you, and I'll go, don't worry about it, Karl. But you didn't even do that.
No, it's the way that you were, like...
I said, where's my 50p? You went, oh, you don't need that. That's not your decision,
I didn't say that. I said, I don't think I've got it at the moment, or whatever.
Rubbish.
And you're going through my pockets and that.
Rubbish.
50p. Ridiculous.
You've just given him a keg of beer for free, hadn't you?
Well, let's not go over it again.
Here we are then, we're back, XFM 104.9. Karl had to leave early last week, but, can you stay to the end this week, mate, or...?
Yeah.
Yeah? You don't need another holiday.
Oh! Oh, he's started already.
I mean, you
Steve's
know,
made you look like a bit of a twat already, and it's only 1:05.
But the only reason you don't go on holiday is because you have to spend money.
Oh, and he's gone straight back!
Well,
he's gone straight
I can't come back to that.
Oh,
it's just dynamite. It's just absolute. That was searing.
Last holiday Steve had, he sort of found a third world country so he could live like a king for a week. It was Cuba, wasn't it?
Going to Cuba, amazing. We can almost rule the place. If it weren't for Castro, I'd have been in charge. Kind of cash I was flashing around. They'll do anything for a dollar over there. It's extraordinary. Literally. I mean, it's amazing.
Yeah. Oh.
Definitely, and I went to Kenya before that.
So he thought, and the prostitute said no.
Mm.
You were going.
Yeah, well, it was $2. I mean, I'm not made of money.
Oh,
but I genuinely, it does frustrate me that I don't get any allowance.
It doesn't
being
count
grateful.
As a disability.
Well, it does count.
No, it doesn't. It's not a disability being 6'7".
But how can you explain, for instance, you know, travelling on a bus or a coach? There's some things I can't see.
The only disadvantage is, people look. I've seen people stare at you. But they stare at me because I've been on the telly. What's that, a disability? Are that people being recognised?
Yes, but you could avoid that by not being on the telly. It's your choice. This is my point. It's your choice.
Yeah,
it's the same
as
the big fat people. It's their choice.
It's a different sort of stare, isn't it? I've been there.
Yeah.
When, you know, the sort of stare that you get and the sort of stare.
Well, obviously, I'm gonna follow up this inquiry. What do you mean, Carl?
No, I'm just saying it's more of a stare of fear than, like, with you, they go, oh, it's him.
Yeah, go on.
Whereas with you, it's more like, jeez.
Where's the monkey news?
Well, we're not gonna do Freak of the Week here.
Okay.
Right? Because we've done quite a bit of that in the last 20 minutes.
We've OD'd on that. Freaks, you think?
Yeah.
Sure.
We'll just shift it a little bit.
Okay.
I keep saying, don't want people to be thinking we're sort of taking the mick out of anyone.
No.
Right? Because we're not about that. I feel like I can do a little bit of it because I work with you, Steve.
Yeah. Right?
Sure. It gives me that right.
It's like a care worker. Yeah, I understand.
Well, it's like that thing of you can't be homophobic because I've got a couple of gay mates and stuff.
Sure.
I think it sort of gives me that edge.
Yeah.
Right? So
you're not freakophobic because you work with Steve?
Yeah, that's right, yeah. So, yeah.
Okay.
Well, by that token, I should be able to sort of slag off, you know, the mentally ill, at least mentally handicapped.
I had some exciting news this week, Karl. You'll be pleased to find out. I'm worried that you might get a little bit jealous because it's obviously going to impact on your world quite strongly. Because I know you think you'd like things to be quite samey. You'd like the status quo to be maintained. You like the fact that in the past, you know, we've had some crosswords. You know, because I remember, what did you think of me when I first walked in? When I first came in on the first day of XFM.
I don't know why you're making a big deal out of it, because I'm just being honest, though. I'm just being honest about a lot of people who see you for the first time sort of go, well, he's a bit weird.
Ooh, I love the fact, Steve, that you brought it up, and then you're again.
But I'm sure that wasn't what he said before.
No,
did he say before?
Yeah, well,
he's a bit weird.
Yeah, well, he looked at you, and I knew, I could see by the look on his face. You know when you know your kid, and your kid's sort of scared of something, and they go, "Why's your kid?" And goes, "Oh, he doesn't like pigeons or spiders."
Right.
It was like that when I saw Karl, and I brought you in, and I went, "What do you think of that, Karl?" I could see the look on his face that he was disturbed.
Sure.
And then, as he said. You get used to it, don't you?
Yeah, you get used to it. And you have changed a little bit. Your hair's a bit smarter now, and you've got some nicer glasses and that, I think. Or I might have just got used to it.
Whoa! Don't bring it up, Steve. Don't look at me like that.
So you say that you think some other people in the office thought the same? Do you know that for sure?
Karl.
Did you discuss it?
Karl.
Yeah, I think they do, yeah.
Okay, leave it there, then.
But not just in the office. As you walk through the building.
Oh, it's worse than you ever thought! Who do you think's cooler to look at, Steve or the Chemical Brothers?
Steve.
Definitely, yes! You're absolutely right, Karl, and that's the first sensible thing you've said for a long time.
If I was to work with Steve on some music,
yeah.
If he had the choice, I think Steve would look better on a album cover.
Really?
Yeah.
What would you do? Would you change him at all? What would you do with his image?
I'd put him in the distance, so I
I can't believe this is- this
No,
is
just so you don't look as tall, that's doing you a favour.
You know, I was on the- this is true, I was on the, on the tube, right, coming in to meet Gervais the other day. And I was wearing a suit, and my mobile phone slipped out of my pocket, and it landed on the seat. And I didn't realise this, and as I was about to get off, some bloke who was sat there like an old guy, he picked up the phone, he went, "Oi! Lanky, you dropped your mobile phone!" And I was like, well, I thank you for pointing out I dropped my phone, but did you have to do the lanky?
But you knew who he meant. I bet you turned round straight away. It worked.
Knew who he meant, Steve.
Yeah, but
he's done you again.
But I was the only person stood up. It was a fairly empty train.
Was there any other lanky people there?
No.
Well then.
150 quid.
Yeah.
What, in gift vouchers?
Yeah.
To spend at the same places.
Mm.
I'd have to say though, I mean, it's not a very inventive gift, is it?
It's
whoever
a came up thought,
with it.
Though.
It's a lovely thought. It's wonderful to have £25 that I can only spend in two places I never go in. But no, I'm not.
Steve,
I'm not looking a gift horse in the mouth.
Any ungrateful,
I'm not
anyway.
Looking a gift horse in the mouth. It is a treat.
He spoke to Jonathan Ross like he was a normal person.
From someone whose dad buys him a spade for Christmas, I thought you'd be grateful.
Yeah.
Before we carry on with anything, I should just tell you, we're on the subject of emails. There's one emailer we're always looking forward to hearing from.
Dickers!
Richie Anderson!
Dicky Docky Do!
Richard Anderson, thanks for emailing.
He's my biggest fan.
He's
now.
One of the biggest fans.
He absolutely loves me.
But not afraid to offer some constructive criticism.
Go on,
that's the
he
great
said.
Thing about Dicky. And from Anders this week, he says, "Ricky, I'm lazy, I talk nonsense, I'm badly organised, and I believe in ghosts. Can I have a job working on your show?" possibly, Anders. Maybe send in a CV. Or email a CV.
He's got a little bit of all of us in that, hasn't
exactly.
he? All right, ask him if he's a goggle-eyed freak, Steve.
All right, calm down.
Well, no, I didn't mean-
No, there's no need to get insulted.
No, I didn't necessarily mean you, did I?
No need to get nasty.
Well-
Also, I was thinking about that, actually, Steve.
Oh, God.
Just talking of- Of the old,
What?
What?
Talking of the what?
No. Do you know, like-
This better be good.
No, you don't have that many girlfriends and
what,
that.
What do you mean?
Karl, why are we on this? I was defending you in the whole monkey discussion. Come on, what's your point? What's your point? What's your point?
No, what's the point? What's the point?
I just was thinking-
If there was an infinite number of Steves?
You're an odd-looking fella.
Come on, Karl, get to the-
No, you know I know that. I've told you that loads of times.
What do you mean, you know I know that?
Well, there's no point pretending anymore.
Steve! I'm flabbergasted.
But also, you don't like spending money, right?
He's mean and weird looking!
Valentine's Day.
I'm gonna- Oh!
Are you sort of, You know.
You've got to love him though, haven't you?
What are you happier with? The fact that no girls like you enough, right?
This is really mental!
Or, are you happy because you don't have to spend any money on a card for someone?
Which... A little from column A, a little from column B.
Wait, let's have more monkey news. What
well,
have we got?
No, we've got a
we've got so much to get into this show. Insults.
We don't
stupidity.
Need the insults. I think we've got enough. We don't need the insults.
Yeah, there's no more insults. No
what
more insults.
What angers me with Karl is you know he's been planning that.
No, I haven't. I was thinking about it on the way in because Valentine's Day is coming up and I'm not a big fan of it.
Right? Condoms.
You bought your girlfriend a box of condoms for Christmas. I don't think you can have a go at me. To be fair.
No, but I don't just treat her on Valentine's. I'm always... Do you know what I mean?
You don't even treat her on Valentine's. You don't even treat her at Christmas or on her birthday. When do you treat her?
Hang on a minute. Wait a cotton picking minute there. Why I order. Wait a minute. What was that? Tiffany dog.
I treat your girlfriend better than you, and I've only met her twice.
He's so ungrateful.
Really?
Yeah.
Because I can't remember a time my dad bought me anything. It's always my mum who bought it, and my dad would give her the money.
Yeah.
You got Ricky who's lost his go-kart. You've had a video bought for you, and you're still not happy. I just think you're selfish.
Now, it's intriguing to me because here's a film called Freaks, featuring real-life freaks, and you're sort of a bit nonplussed by it.
Just because it wasn't, because it's built up. If you call a video Freaks, you've got to make sure that there's some good stuff on there.
Yeah.
What were you disappointed about? Was it that?
Because there was a few things on it, right? There was a woman who said she was half man, half woman. And it's like, well, you're not, are you? It was just like she had some makeup on. I thought, well, that's rubbish. And then there was a woman who could eat using her feet. That isn't that freaky. Do you know what I mean? If she's not hungry, she looks normal.
Yeah.
And that's when I was thinking... I mean, I'm not being right, Steve. You know I'm not being funny.
Oh, here we go.
No, but I'm just saying, if that woman wasn't eating and you were sat next to her in that film,
yeah,
I'd probably be sort of drawn to you more than her. I'm not... I know you hate me saying it, but there's no point sort of pretending. Do you know what I mean?
Oi, Muttley, what are you sniggering about?
That face. Well, you mean there were things in it that were less. What are you saying?
I'm just saying.
Play a record. No, seriously, I'll slap you. I'm going to slap you live on air.
Yeah, but you always get.
I'm slapping you live on air. I swear to God.
Right, play a song then.
He's playing
a song.
I'll
play a song. Keep the finger up.
It's happening again, Steve.
What's happening?
It's going all wrong. Yeah. We're talking rubbish.
Are we?
Yeah.
We should have played two in a row.
He's having a go, isn't he?
Blimey.
Can I just kiss and make up with Karl?
No, that is...
No, let me just kiss my kiss.
Yeah, but it doesn't... Next week it'll be the same again. What, it doesn't mean anything. It's like saying sorry.
It's on the lips.
Go on, he's... Oh, like. I've never. Carl has gone a absolute shade of purple, straining not to have merchants.
There's no point, Steve.
No.
There's no point.
No, just shake. Just shake and make up.
Shake what, really?
There you go. All friends, sit down. That's lovely. That's a lovely moment.
Shut up!
They got two monkeys, right?
And don't! Oh,
because they'd seen the owners. They'd seen the owners with guns and what have you.
No!
Yeah, that sounds
possible. So they had a bit of a shoot-off.
Yeah.
That's how they sorted it out.
And who won?
I think it was George. The one called George.
Right.
So they had, I think they had 17 kids. The farm's still running. So that's like the last little monkey news there. Good little
Rick,
happy ending
count
to that one.
If you were to rub your nipple against his lips while I held him down.
Right, come off it now. Come on. No, I'm not doing it.
Bruce Springsteen, Thunder Road, last track on Next FM's with
I'm
you,
not
Steve.
Doing it.
You can check this all out on the webcam.
I'm not.
I've got fingers.
No.
Get the arm out of the way.
This happened on Scum.
Mary's dress weeds like a vision.